Hey guys, Slynk here with another tutorial finally. Remember a few months ago when Ableton 11 was announced and I said this? I mean, this whole plugin really needs its own video to explain everything about how cool this is. Well, this is going to be that video. So let's jump in, take a look at exactly what Hybrid Reverb is and why it's really, really awesome. And I've been using it for a few months now and I've got a few tricks up my sleeve that I'm going to show you. So let's get started. So Hybrid Reverb is called Hybrid Reverb because it's actually two reverbs in one. You've got the convolution reverb side on this side and the algorithmic reverb on this side. And Hybrid Reverb gives you five different choices of algorithm on the algorithmic side. An algorithmic reverb, by the way, is just sort of like an algorithm with a bunch of delays with different decay times and filters and stuff that all come together to create a reverb-y sounding effect. And each one of these algorithms have a different flavor. They all have their different sort of settings that you can play with to shape the reverb into exactly how you want it to sound. A convolution reverb uses something called an impulse response as a sort of blueprint to shape your sound. It kind of works like a vocoder where you have one sound being modulated by another, and the result is essentially a reverb that sounds very real, or it can sound very unnatural and weird. It all depends on what sort of impulse response you use. And Hybrid Reverb comes with a ton of different impulse responses. It actually comes with 235 impulse responses. And on top of that, you can drag any audio file in to this window and use that as an impulse response, even if it isn't a real impulse response. It could just be like your cat meowing or something. And you get some really weird and interesting results. So on top of that, you can run both of these different sides in serial, meaning first it calculates the convolution reverb side and then feeds the result of that into the algorithmic side for a second round of reverb treatment. Or you can change it to parallel mode. So both sides are receiving the incoming signal separately. They do their thing separately, and then it spits out a sum of the both. And you can run each side individually with the other side turned off. So that's really cool. But the best thing is you can blend between the two, and this knob can be automated. I mean, this plugin is so cool. There's so much to unpack here. We're just getting started. So I've got this short pop sound that we're going to use to demonstrate the power of the Hybrid Reverb. Now, right now I've got the algorithmic side turned off and we're just going to be using the convolution side. And I'm checking out some of the early reflections impulse responses. This one sounds really cool. It's just like a really tight, wide kind of room sound. If I wanted to kind of extend the decay of that, you can see we're at maximum. It's a really short impulse response. So the idea here is to feed this impulse response into an algorithmic reverb using serial mode. So let's just focus on algorithmic mode for a second here, and we'll find something that sounds kind of cool. We've got the dark hall, maybe prism. Whoa, that's pretty cool. So let's blend them together using serial mode. So it sounds pretty interesting. It's definitely a lot different to just the algorithmic side and just the convolution side. Serial mode is best used when we're using a short or strange impulse response on this side, and parallel mode kind of works best when you're sort of using a longer, more natural sounding impulse response on this side. Maybe something from like the Real Places or Chambers and Large Rooms folder in conjunction with the algorithmic reverb, and sort of blend in between the both of them like this. So now we have like a more textured sort of reverb result there. So I've got a little drum break here. Sounds like that. And I'm going to turn the Hybrid Reverb on, and we're just using the convolution side at the moment. And I'm going to choose one of these early reflections again. Let's try this one. Now, if we turn the feedback up, you can get some pretty interesting results. This comb space one has a lot of extra sort of reflections. pretty interesting, very dubby. But I think my favorite is having a short pre-delay and a high feedback, because you get a sort of tone almost. And then what would happen if we fed that into an algorithmic reverb? Now what would happen if we, because that's a note, right? Let's freeze this algorithmic side. Okay, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. I think we need to record that. That's pretty crazy. I bet we could use that in a sampler to create almost like an atmospheric pad. It's also a great way to make a riser too. Just pitch bend it. Wonder what happens if we put like an oscillator and FM this thing. This might be a really good layer for a bass line. Like if that was like a top layer. This is starting to enter drum and bass territory, I would say. Let's put a hybrid reverb on there now to see if we can get even more texture out of this crazy sound we've just created. So we definitely want to be using the EQ in this case to kind of dampen the amount of reverb that's affecting the low end. We could even dial back the highs as well. And let's try something weird, like one of these textures, perhaps. I think I like the Jenna Marbles texture. Cool, that's a pretty cool bass that we made out of freezing the reverb from a drum break. And we use that as a texture above an operator. The operator is just playing a kind of a standard sort of. Standard sort of re-space. These are all just sine waves, and this one's slightly detuned from this one, and this one is an octave above. Oh yeah, and then on the filter we have like shaping hard and the filter drives all the way up and stuff. So sounds pretty cool. Anyway, speaking of the freeze button, we can automate the freeze button using an envelope follower on this drum break. Check this out. If we get the sensitivity just right, it can actually end up sounding really cool. And then let's play with the size and the distance at the same time. What if we also map the envelope follower to the distance? Because that was sounding kind of cool. You can map multiple things with these modulators, which is awesome. This is getting super weird and I love it. If crazy weird sound design isn't really your thing, you can use this envelope follower on the dry wet and invert the range here so that every time a kick or drum sample plays, it actually kind of ducks or sidechains the reverb out of the way. So check it out. But yeah, if you dial that in, it can actually sound like a really nice sort of automatic sidechain. Okay, so let's start experimenting with creating our own custom impulse responses. I'm going to create a new channel here and just set it to record my microphone. I'm just going to step away and clap around my room. Yeah, let's try this one as an impulse response. And let's drag it into Hybrid Reverb. Let me try this on a different sound. I'll just get an analog to play a saw wave. That's kind of what my room sounds like. I guess if my room was like 300% bigger, that's kind of what it would sound like. What if my room was 40% of the current size? I gotta say, I think Quartz is my favorite algorithm. It's like really fun to play with the distance and size. It's definitely the most synthwave algorithm. And actually, to make it even more synthwavy, we can turn up the vintage. That sounds pretty cool. I think the extreme amount of vintage is a little too much. The older one is my favorite. You know what? We have to get an LFO moving this distance knob around because that sounds too cool. Let's try it out. Maybe it needs to be more jittery and crazy. Let's try that. That almost sounds like rain or like vinyl distortion. Okay, so we're not done playing with custom impulse responses just yet. I've got this sample of C3PO saying, "Oh, switch off." And I think I'm just gonna isolate this switch part.
Switch, switch.
And then maybe what we'll do is put a hybrid reverb on this to create our own impulse response using, let's just say, the algorithm side.
Switch, switch.
And we'll just freeze and flatten that. And let's try that as an impulse response.
Zero, one.
Let's try this sample. Wow, it's like a vocoder. That's so cool. Every bass note you play now, it says, "I win." Let's try like a scratch sound, like, Okay, you can only drag WAV files in. It doesn't work with MP3s.
But not a lot of resources when it comes to the tiny island nation.
I wonder how long it can last for.
But not a lot of resources when it comes to the tiny island nation.
Pretty long. It's all fun and games to just mess around with throwing whatever sample you like into the hybrid reverb. But what if you wanted to accurately measure a impulse response? Let's say you took your laptop and a microphone to a church hall or some underground piping or something, and you wanted to actually record the impulse response in that area. You'd have to bring speakers as well, but this is how you would do it. In the Max for Live Essentials pack, under Max Audio Effects and Convolution Reverb, there's an impulse response measurement device that you can use. Then you just set it to external in and select your microphone and then set it to input mode. And now you can choose your settings, what kind of measurement you'd like to take, how loud you want to play it out of your speakers, and what kind of sweep, how long of a sweep you want to do. I'm just going to do like a quick measure. There's also impulses and stuff as well you can try. So what this is going to do once I click this button is it's going to play a frequency sweep from, you know, 0 hertz to 20,000 hertz out of my speakers, and then it will be recording what's happening on my microphone, and then the measurement tool will determine what kind of impulse response my room has. So let's give it a try. And there we go, measurement done. So we can just click save. We can save this on the desktop, tutorial IR. So this is what we got. It gives you a left and a right, so we can consolidate those into one file. That's what it sounds like. I'll pan this one right, pan this one left, and then I'll just resample that really quickly. Let's throw that in our hybrid reverb and see what our room sounds like. That's the impulse response of my actual room, which is pretty cool. And then we can change the size of it. So you don't really need to go digging around in sewer pipes or anything to get a pretty cool impulse response. Another interesting test is to put a weird effect on after this impulse measurement device to see how that affects the creation of a measurement. Let's give it a try. And we click save, call it tutorial IR2, and then we'll drag the left and the right signals in again. And always, as you can see, they're a lot longer this time. And we'll just quickly record these. Let's drag it into our hybrid reverb. So, what does this tell us? Well, if you had reverb gear like a hardware reverb, you could use this technique to actually sample and measure the impulse response of your hardware reverb at its current settings, and then use your reverb more conveniently just in Ableton without having to rig it all up and record it every time. So using this impulse measurement device can be pretty handy. And you can also get more creative than this. We just put in a reverb on here. But what if we use something more crazy, like a spectral time plugin or maybe a grain delay? There's a million options, and we can sample the impulse responses that we measure with those and then use them in hybrid reverb. Hybrid reverb is a super powerful effect. And even after recording this entire video, I still feel like we've only just started to scratch the surface of what's actually possible with hybrid reverb. You know, there's so many custom impulse responses to try out, so many frozen reverbs to sample and put into a sampler, and so many impulse algorithm combinations to try out as well. I feel like there's a ton of applications that I haven't even thought of yet. It's definitely one of my favorite additions to Live 11, and I'm going to be using it all the time. So definitely let me know if you've been using hybrid reverb, if you have a favorite algorithm, or if you have come up with any interesting creative ways to use hybrid reverb, let me know in the comments. Personally, my favorite has got to be the Quartz algorithm. I love playing with the distance and the size. It sounds all choppy. It sounds very synth wavy. I love it. So cool. I hope you enjoyed the video. I'll catch you next time. Peace.